Well, that didn't take long. Fresh out of his win in court, Edward Rogers moved decisively to replace Rogers CEO Joe Natale. So, what should the new CEO do to operate successfully within this unique context? I've got five suggestions based on my work with family-controlled company boards all over the world. Number one, set appropriate expectations. Running a family-controlled company as CEO, especially with a family executive chair, is a very different context than running a widely held public company. Many CEOs who do particularly well in these types of roles tell me that what they enjoy about it the most is that they get to look the shareholder in the eye. And to them, it underscores the impact of their decisions on the family, the company, its history, and its legacy. And they find it really rewarding. But for a type A limelight-seeking CEO, they're often not comfortable sharing power in this way, and it inevitably leads to a contentious relationship. Secondly, confirm and even consider redesigning the executive chair role for Edward. The roles of chair and CEO always need to be well-defined and well-understood by the two people playing them. But it's particularly important when you've got a family executive chair. Rather than some cookie-cutter governance template, these tend to work best when the executive chair role is actually designed for the person playing it to capitalize on their strengths and expertise. Never forget that in family-controlled companies, family members who have essentially inherited their board seats are viewed as corporate royalty. And it's important to capitalize on that because it's actually a corporate asset. Number three for the new CEO of Rogers is to make sure that you build a relationship with every member of the board. It's easy to focus on Edward, and clearly that's a pivotal relationship. But it would be a grave mistake to ignore the other directors. And I'll tell you why. In this power structure, it can be extremely useful for a CEO to have other directors to candidly kick around ideas with, get their insights, and they can even run some interference with the chair behind the scenes and create a lot smoother operation of different ideas for the CEO. They can provide advice, guidance, and support, and that's going to be invaluable. Number four is to insist on an annual evaluation of the chair. No, Edward isn't going anywhere, but this is the best professional development there is for a chair. Now, I'm not talking about some sort of sham process with the chairs doing their own evaluation or they've got some sort of perfunctory survey. So, what would probably work best would be to bring in a third party, have them conduct confidential interviews with everybody on the board, everybody in the senior team, and their goal is to really probe to provide Edward with worthwhile, actionable, balanced feedback. Yes, he can choose to ignore it, but I've been doing director evaluations since 1996, and it is the best professional development tool I've ever found. And I think in this context, it could be absolutely invaluable. Fifth, the new CEO needs to carefully design their strategy process. Many CEOs, strategy is at the heart of their job. And so they'll come to the board and say, okay, here's my strategy. Are there any questions? That would be a grave mistake in this situation. You want to design the process to be far more collaborative between the board and management. And in fact, this is a direction I think boards around the world are going to anyway, but in this context, it's particularly important. You really want to take advantage not only of Edward's insights in terms of developing strategy to ensure that there's alignment, you should always also be harnessing the talent and expertise of the other people at the board. There are some people on the Rogers board who have very impressive backgrounds, and taking full advantage of that is going to not only add value for the CEO, it will for the company, for the family, and for the other shareholders as well.